Good afternoon. Let me introduce myself. My name is Nina Gorelitsva. I'm a postgraduate student at the Siberian Federal University. I'm from Krasnoyarsk, Russia. I'd like to present to you the results of the research obtained in collaboration with our industrial partners, Rusal ITC. The title of our presentation is Method of Protection of Cathode Blocks of Aluminum Electrolysis Cells. I have divided my report into four parts. Firstly, I will consider the failure mechanism of cathode blocks. Secondly, I will move on to the additional titanium boride powders characterization. Then, I will present the result of development of a protective coating based on titanium boride. And to conclude, I would like to talk about the industrial application of protective coating. Before starting, I would like to talk about the electrolysis cell construction. This slide shows the design of high amperage aluminum reduction cell. The electrolysis cell device consists of a cathode and anode. Between them, an electrolyte and molten aluminum. The main subject of this study is the carbon cathode blocks. The schematic representation of cathode blocks is also presented on the slide. The lifetime of an aluminum electrolysis cell is mainly determined by the cathode wear. The cathode's wear is caused by two main factors: chemical formation, dissolution and transport of aluminum carbide, and mechanical abrasion of unprotected surfaces of cathode materials and penetration on sodium into the cathode blocks. You can see here the double wear cross-section profile of cathode wear, which is usually observed. To solve this problem and to prevent the cathode block surface degradation, the development of wettable protective coating is required. Thus, the aim of our research is to increase the lifetime of aluminum electrolysis cells. To achieve it, the following stages will be realized. The first stage is to study mechanism of carbon cathode blocks failure under severe conditions. The second stage is to develop the compositions of wettable Tibor-based material for carbon cathode protection and the cost-effective method of the coating. And the third is to put protective coating into industrial applications. Let us look now at initial titanium boride powders characterization results. The result of same micrograms and particle size distribution for the powders are presented on the slide. Here we can see that TD1 powder was a large particle size distribution. For TD2 powder, a multimodal particle size distribution is observed. TD3 powder doesn't contain a small fraction. Particles from large aggregates and have an irregular morphology. Now we will look at the description of experimental procedure. three commercial titanium boride powders with different particle size and a commercial water soluble environmentally friendly binder were selected to provide a protective coating. Components were mixed with a high-speed mixer in order to avoid the agglomeration and the subsidence of titanium boride particles. The resulting coating composition was applied to carbon cathode substrate and formate laboratory specimens in order to measure physical and mechanical properties of material. After that, the resulting composition was dried at room temperature during 48 hours, next heated to 950 degrees, held for 5 hours, and finally cooled at room temperature. The burning in laboratory chamber furnace coating was protected against oxidation using a graphite powder. This slide demonstrates the measurement methods and equipment used to determine the physical and mechanical properties of laboratory coating samples. Let us now turn to the basic properties of the obtained protective coating. Two types of protective coating were developed. One is based on of TD1 powder with a large particle size distribution. The other is based on a mixture of TD2 and TD3 powders. The relationship between the coating composition, the microstructure and the properties of coating were investigated. The result presented in the table show that the coating based on TD1 powder was lower open porosity and electrical resistivity, and higher bulk density and compressive strength than coating based on a mixture of TD2 and TD3 powders. The figures show the same micrograph of the coating based on TD1 powder. Cross-section analysis shows that the interface between coating and carbon cathode substrate was good adhesion strength. Now will we move on to industrial application of protective coating. The surface of the industrial carbon cathode blocks was coated with a proposed coating composition according to cathode wear profile. In areas where the wear was more intensive, as it shows on the picture, there are two strips along the periphery of the electrolysis cell with width 600 mm and thickness of 3 mm. Also, here you see a comparison between cathode wear rate with and without using protective coating. Due to the use of protective coating, the lifetime of the electrolysis cells was increased by 4 months. In conclusion, I would like to sum up the main points again. Firstly, mechanisms of cathode blocks failure in operating condition were studied. The main ones and mechanical wear, which includes mechanical abrasion of unprotected surface of cathode materials, dry to high speeds of metal and electrolyte, and penetration of sodium into the cathode material, and chemical wear, which include formation, dissolution, and transport of aluminum carbide. Secondly, Tiberite to basic protective coating composition was developed. Composition based on TDA1 powder showed the high physical and mechanical properties compared to a mixture of TDA2 and TDA3 powders. Thirdly, cathode wearite dried to application of protective coating decreases by 1.8 times. And the lifetime of aluminum electrolysis cell increases by 4 months. To conclude, costs of manufacturing and planning of developing protective coating is of by increasing the lifetime of the electrolysis cells within 0.5 months.